Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Secret Life of Science, How It Really Works and Why It Matters, by Jeremy J. Baumberg, narrated by Rory Barnett. Publisher's note, this audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type The Secret Life of Science into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page, then under the Supplemental Content section, please enter the access code Newton and then click the Unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. 1. Questing Science. What science gets done? Why do we do science? As a teenager, I took the answer for granted. We explore, as we have always explored, our own worlds, peaks and rifts, forests and plains, as we clamour to explore other planets and comets. Now that I deal in science, I know this cannot be enough, cannot tell us why we all are forced to learn science in school and insist that our children do too, cannot tell us why we spend so much of our financial resources and invest our hopes in science. With explorers, there were always only a few, and yet with scientists, we have now grown a vast abundance. Why, my daughter asked at breakfast this morning, why is it bad to drain marshes if it stops mosquitoes breeding? Nowadays, a quick web search with her rapidly shows how much science has accumulated behind this query. We read online studies that summarise why drainage can be both good and bad, short-term and long-term, why every component in the natural cycle is linked into so many others, that simple predictions don't often work out. For every why, there are lines of Russian dolls stretching out to the horizon, waiting to be opened up to reveal new chambers of information, each gleaned over decades of careful scientific investigation. We take our science for granted, that scientists are everywhere around us, that their breed isn't dying out or losing its way, or that it isn't driving its convoys up blind alleys. We assume science will keep on trotting out its miracles that get ever further from our human experience and deeper into imaginative territories. But how do we know it is in good shape? You pay for it in multiple ways, but do you care for it? Do you nurture science? What science are you being offered? Which fragments from the vast terrain? Our societies have discovered that science is a powerful stimulus. It shocks and challenges us, it creates visionary ambitions, and its dopamine-fueled lure is a natural focus for the human mind that loves aha. We trust scientific results that stand the brutal tests of criticism and time. We are so confident in this that we believe any self-aware civilization anywhere in the universe would agree with our own established scientific principles. On the other hand, the way that this self-aware civilization went about studying science would likely be completely baffling to us. The scientific system we have created is not a foregone conclusion. Ancient cultures did not have formal organizations to explore the natural world. Instead, it was left to the curious few who carved themselves temporarily safe niches within their societies. The construction of formalized institutions, such as universities, around the world, which foster learning and organized discussion, is one of the many unremarked miracles of our current lives. Just what science gets done is much more determined by our culture than is the objective truth of our science. The essential need for repeatability and testability in science means that any crack or flaw in the network of interconnected ideas is mostly quickly identified. But what we decide to expend our limited resources on within this infinite structure is not obviously clear. Approaching the scientific enterprise from the outside, you might imagine that what gets done is formed on agreement between leaders, or emerges from a sort of signposting by nature that is apparent to anyone looking dispassionately at each scientific subfield. My own discussions with public focus groups often bring out their belief that surely someone is directing the entire science operation. but the truth is much more complicated, and far closer to the way we steer our economy, buffeted by inevitable fashions, gurus, and cycles of booms and busts caused by our social interactions. It is virtually impossible in any country to identify who made a decision to do this piece of science. On the other hand, most countries are effectively locked into competition to do the best science by trying to identify it and fund it. As I tried to answer my own questions about the web in which I am involved, I became ever more fascinated with accounting for why I do what I do, and surprised by what this investigation says might be usefully changed. This book tries to capture what influences the science that gets done and why it matters. To do that, we have to look at the motivations of everyone involved, beyond those of just the researchers themselves. The view I will elaborate is that it helps to consider the full ecosystem of science. Ecosystems help us see how chunks of the natural world balance themselves through relationships between many natural organisms all at once. The different parts of the science system act similarly as interrelating organisms. Intense competition, not just between scientists, but between research journals that publish results, universities that house researchers, newspapers, governments, subject areas, and many other contestants, favours survival skills. The resulting ecosystem of science has its own personality and temperament, which leads it towards a future that we might all want to have our own say in. This book maps my own explorations, asking questions that both scientists and non-scientists have been confused by, and I am startled to find are not well known. Although it has been useful to be a practicing scientist, this is not necessary to appreciate the stories that emerge. In their telling, we might actually understand what it is that our societies want scientists to do. Figure 1.1 in the bonus PDF. In starting to map out the territories of this book, I realised that there really is no good place to find a description of the way science actually works. This landscape turns out to be complicated, interesting, and connected. And yet it should also influence how we read explanations of scientific results, visions, funding, and ambition. Many of the issues I raise can be found in fragments across blogs and letters pages, and discussed by scientists, sometimes widely. However, each mini-debate is part of a wider frustration that I sense in scientists themselves, of being trapped in a system not of their making. And even worse, they feel that they are powerless to modify this system, because its meshing cogs are so finely aligned that no change is independent of every other part. This book is thus also a stimulus to restore balance, for non-scientists to regain some insight and control into what happens with their funds, and for scientists to regain some insight and control into how it happens. Why should we care? We pay for science. We accept the tantalizing gifts it provides, though we are sometimes nervous about their effects or about their ethics. And science will frame our future, the future for our children, and the long, deep future for humans on this planet. On average, we each pay only a few hundred dollars a year to support science. Not very much compared to what we burn up just driving around. But this is one of the best investments we make in our collective future, returning far more than any other opportunity for our savings. How this investment is spent on our behalf is a very peculiar thing, and this is another story of this book. The increasing wealth of our societies has nurtured the growth of a new ecosystem, both insulated from and buffeted by wider forces across society, in which science is mined, amassed, archived, and expanded. The book is planned as a survey, focusing on different parts of the system in turn to see how the overlapping spheres of influence mesh together to create a science ecosystem. I start with the science itself and show how scientists are fragmented between a pair of interdependent roles. I also ask how realistically we can view science as its own ecosystem, and how this raises questions to consider about science. To ground our discussions, I review motivations for doing science in Chapter 3, using the lens of what scientists have thought most important over the past half century. In mapping the chains of influence, the next three chapters consider in turn how scientists present their newfound knowledge, how they hear about it from each other, and finally, how we all across society get to hear about it through the media. These illuminate the flows that bind the spheres of knowledge, people, and media around scientists themselves. Later in Chapter 7, I explore what resources go into science and who controls where this money flows. How the people who make this all happen are shaped along the way is sketched out in Chapter 8, to complete the survey of the overlapping spheres and their myriad internal competitions. In Chapter 9, I pull all this together to consider how evolution in this landscape is responsible for its current situation, before making some suggestions about ways we might change it in the final chapter, offering tentative prescriptions. Rather than a polemical stance, my main aim is to describe what the state of science really is and how it works. I am a practicing scientist and thus deeply implicated in the system, and I had an early career in industry and so already approached research with one eye refracting the perspective of an outsider's prism. My aim is to write as an outsider might look in, as a science sociologist of the mainstream, laying bare the construction of this science system. Popular accounts of science instead tend to focus on larger-than-life personalities, early historical perspectives, and to lay out compilations of mythical and anecdotal stories to provide colour and moral fables. I am going in a different direction, both because my theme is about the wider interactions, but also because I want to capture what we have now and where it might be going. Along the way, I find many questions whose answers I felt I ought to know. How many scientists are there in the world? How many less will there be in 10 years? Of the thousands of papers published each day, why do a few get into our newspapers and Twitter streams? Who chooses for us and why? Who chooses what sort of science gets done? What do scientists read? How do they choose what science to do? Are there too many biologists in the world or too few? What sets the size of a science conference? These are not part of my background knowledge, nor that of most scientists. Science is in rude health, never having been better funded or producing more results. Any system has its flaws, though, and in science many are well known. Influences of money and self-interest, sporadic scandals of distorted or false data and conclusions, sensationalisms of wild hype or wild personalities, distorted reporting from the media circus, or individuals stealing credit. All these are persistently aggravating to the cause of science, but they do not fundamentally undermine it because of the self-correcting way that it works. However, another set of deeper worries will emerge from my survey here, ones that are an implicit part of the system of science itself. The contested interactions that are integral to the science ecosystem are inflating competition between its different components. This ever-tightening set of global competitions skews how the system works and evolves. Through this book, I hope to show why I am no longer quite so convinced about the globalization of science, and why I believe science might be expanding too much. These competitions have other effects that will become apparent, such as reducing the diversity in how science is funded and appreciated. All these pressures focus on the scientist who, contrary to conceptions of airy independence from societal pressures, is at the nexus of some of the most intense global struggles. But to start at the beginning, we first need to ask what we mean by science. 2. What is science? Most people have a comfortable familiarity with the idea of science. My task, though, is to prise apart this solid-seeming notion of what it is, and to locate two contrasting types of science inquiry and what drives each one. To understand the ecosystem as a whole, I then want to tackle how many researchers there are at the moment and how this is changing. This tribe of scientists is at the core of the science ecosystem, and I will discuss how they divide themselves within it. Finally, I will discuss how the science ecosystem might work, mapping out the different parts we will visit on this tour. The roles of scientists. Science in our surroundings. Look around you now. What do you see that a spirited woman teleported forward through time from prehistory might recognize or understand? Tables, floors, sockets, screens, lights, windows. All are absent from the natural world. All offer intricate wonders. What would intrigue your prehistoric visitor most? Each object has myriad stories to tell, ways of understanding culture, history, science, and technology, all blended. Correspondingly, how do your surroundings intrigue you, and what questions emerge from where your gaze alights? How is that glittering shard of light hitched by wires to the wall, spilling colours over the room? Perhaps you are puzzled by the inaudibly chattering microwaves from your mobile devices ricocheting off your friends and your floors, passing tenuously through walls. How come this metal spoon feels hot, while the porous ceramic of your coffee mug that holds it is not? How are the clumped words on this page leaving indelible chemical marks in your brain for you to reconsider in your pauses? Science is not only so concretely apparent. Perhaps you are more concerned about invisible fears raised by hectoring all around us. What is really aloft in the air we are breathing, visible as that sulphur yellow-white horizon smog? How much guilt did that ear-tautening plane journey add to how you feel about our use of planetary resources? Is an article you read really showing a promising cure for cancer? These days of viewing the world, asking the why is it, why does it do this questions are the natural pesterings of a scientific stance. Mostly, our questioning attitude starts near home. Why we are ticklish, why only some of us, and then what tickling might be for? How do dogs navigate over long distances so well? Such questions often still don't have answers that fully satisfy us. But science questions roam much further. While existing natural things just are what they are, interlocking into an accepted part of our worlds, new invented devices are weirdly fascinating. Thumbnails that store all our music, glittering black solar panels that feed our energy habit, the dazzle of technologies that make miracles, fleeting glimpses of their inner science, only hinting at the underpinnings that drive them. How do these ways of seeing our surroundings relate to science? When are we actually doing science? And what does it mean to be doing science? The pages of newspapers and websites offer a glimpse of the problem of defining science and categorizing its activities. As I write this, my web feed has pieces about the particle accelerator at CERN under science. Polar bear feeding ranges are climate change. And discussions about battery storage concepts are technology. Are all these science too? Can scientists work on technology or the environment? To deal with this fuzziness, I will first revisit where science emerged from. Where are our stereotypes? Our idea of what science encapsulates constantly changes. From the 16th century, natural philosophy labelled those eccentrics musing about the physical realms and its increasingly fertile experimental methods. While the label science came from the Greek for the whole of knowledge, it was soon captured by those focusing solely on the natural and physical domains. By the mid-1800s, scientists were seen as those who sought knowledge from nature only. 100 years ago, we had emerging stereotypes. lone scientists devoted to understanding an enigmatic nature, gluttonous collectors labelling abstruse specimens from one of nature's rich niches, entrepreneurial technologists hammering out fixes to problems that people will pay for. But things have moved on a century, and while the appetite for peeking over the shoulders of scientists has become even more compelling to funders and the public alike, our old categories divide poorly. Scientists and technologists constantly influence each other. Greek-speaking scholars fleeing the Turks influenced an Italian humanist movement, keen to rediscover classical literature and revitalized science knowledge, idolized now as the Renaissance. When the Black Death made labor expensive in the 14th century, technology grew in importance, milking this nascent science for manufacturing materials and devices that could turn a profit. Gutenberg's printing advances in the 15th century distributed this knowledge widely, while the improving ship technologies enabled the collection of new discoveries from far and wide. Systemization of this arrayed knowledge cried out for the explanatory power of science. Industrialization accelerated these cycles of science and technology, with huge effects in alleviating the drudgery of living by the 20th century. Our current crop of scientists inherits these multiple motivations. Typically, scientists are divided into pure and applied, taken to mean those who study the natural world and those who try to create useful things from this knowledge. Note firstly how emotive these labels are, since purity emphasizes a greater virtue in opposition to polluting influences. In society, it is associated with ideas such as racial or sexual purity, defining implicitly an undesirable dark side. To understand what motivates scientists, I believe that it is more useful to employ a different and more neutral dichotomy, which emphasizes the roles they take when doing science. I will describe these as simplifiers and constructors, and show how they both create fundamental scientific knowledge. Introducing simplifiers. Consider the bands of physicists who survey the nature of different subatomic particles and what component particles these in turn might be made up of. Some ask, why do the particles have this mass, or why do they collide in this manner to produce a shower of new particles? They strip down complexity to identify more basic component properties, ways that allow us to explain what we see in simple concepts. Such scientists I will call simplifiers, though related epithets might be explorers, delvers, or deconstructors. Their relation to the world is of opening the box of magic and trying to understand how it works, and they are the reductionists of science. It is not obvious at the outset of any scientific journey that a simplifier's approach might work at all. Simplifications seem to be possible only because the underlying physical behavior of the world is really governed by laws that conserve various underlying essences. We know that energy is conserved, momentum is conserved, and the number of atoms is conserved. These laws can all be broken in various ways. We can convert energy to mass and back. We can lose atoms from a body by abrasion or chemical conversion into gases. We can convert atoms from one to another in nuclear reactions. What is most useful is that the underlying reasoning behind these laws allows us to convert questions we have now into close correspondence with questions we have asked before, and this allows us to form a scientific intuition. Each situation is not new, but related to those considered before. Without such order, intuition is very difficult to achieve, swamped by a morass of details and information fragments. Simplifiers are at work within every domain of science. Do simplifiers kill beauty? Simplifiers are associated with several different emotional reactions to science. They have long been a target for romantics of the world who see the uncovering of inner workings as inhumanly mechanistic and killing the essence of outward beauty. To some, knowing the simpler reasons that animate complex phenomena, such as why rainbows are coloured, is seen as stripping them of power, life, and energy. Similar allegations are made about the destruction wrought by analysing poetry, literature, or art. On the other hand, simplifiers are seen as great explorers who find new unknowns in the universe to boldly go beyond. This pioneering aspect particularly unfolds in large-scale mega-science projects such as particle accelerators, where the stress is on the romance of breaking boundaries of knowledge and providing new understandings of our human place in the cosmos. They are the knights who vanquish the implacable dragons, overturning past theories. This long-standing fight back by simplifiers inverts the charge of killing the world when pinning its beauty to a board, like lifeless butterflies. Every person stares at stars and can be awed. Knowing that huge balls of squeezed fusing gases glare out at us, blowing off immense canopies of glowing streamers, only adds to our awe. Figure 2.1 in the bonus PDF. While reduction is indeed part of the task of simplification in science, it is not a reduction in content, but a transformation in the task of comprehending, from voluminous fact to stacking and interleaving of scientific principles and implications. This is what is meant by understanding some piece of science. Compressing information. For simplifiers, a satisfactory outcome in a scientific field is information compression. They aim for fewer facts and more connecting description, often in the form of equations defining relationships, to directly account for the world. Sometimes they can show why information compression is not possible, such as in predicting weather, which we are used to knowing only days in advance. In other areas, such as predicting the large fluctuations in the stock market, we find it hard to accept such unpredictability. It is interesting that situations where simplifiers currently hold most authority are now those parts of science least amenable to repeated human experimentation, and those that possess a very large number of complex components. These include cosmology, why the distribution of stars, galaxies, quasars and black holes appears as it does. Biology, what is alive, how do cells work, how does the brain work, and how do we experience consciousness? And particle physics, why is there so little antimatter in the universe, which gives the most basic particles known their mass and charge? And what do we really mean by mass and charge? Challenges exist for every discipline in situations where full control remains difficult and observations are problematic. Simplifier science is easiest and has worked best when we can twiddle all the knobs on the box, and if we break it, we can try another box. Where this has been possible, simplifiers have already swept through triumphant. Science can get into difficulties, though, when testability or repeatability is challenging. If scientists have a theory about how the world works, they need it to make predictions. But if such predictions play out over millennia and involve scales beyond our control, such as collisions between stars, then scientists cannot set up an experiment and wait to check that their expectations are fulfilled. Nor can they try this experiment several times to check it works, even with small variations in the initial setup conditions, to test if the predictions are robust. Similarly, it is not yet possible to set up a particular set of thoughts or new memories in someone's brain and observe the repeatable electrical firing of billions of neurons. Problems with testability and repeatability are found in disciplines and questions that are precisely the ones which have not proceeded so far, because we cannot travel experimentally in lockstep with our theories. Instead, scientists have to resort to observations in which they catch specific occurrences in the act, looking everywhere in the cosmos with telescopes to find a few galactic collisions, or they wait until something they want to test comes along, watching a brain seizure develop. Such a strategy depends on the richness and density of components under study, stars, neurons. This makes the strategy rather more difficult for improbable events or those in sparse situations, such as abrupt climate changes, stock market crashes, supernovas, or the development of life on a planet. As a result, we have a distinct class of hard science problems in which simplifiers are currently richly represented, but that are hardly amenable to testability. These must be set against a huge number of scientific areas in which the simplifier approach has already been enormously successful, such as electronics or molecular bonding. The result of those has been a highly compressed information web that is the seed for much new science. Most of these mapped areas are ones with multiple types of amenable experiments, giving great assurance to the credibility of our scientific understanding. They allow confident predictions about the world, which will be important for the other way of doing science, discussed later. It is the success of simplifiers in compressing information that leads to the second role for scientists that I now describe. Introducing constructors. Once simplifiers can confidently predict how a chunk of the world works, a new phalanx of questions emerge that head in completely different directions. How can we use this breakthrough not just to simplify, but to build something? Descriptions based not on assemblies of facts, but on toolboxes harnessing interactions and conservation laws, inherently give birth to a different sort of creativity that generalizes these to new arenas. What happens if I do this to that, or how might this operate if I heat it? Notice that this sort of science is not directly asking how an aspect of nature works. It is already making constructs, mostly never found before in nature, in which questions of how it works are always twinned with how can we make it work differently? For this reason, I will refer to such scientists as constructors, though related descriptions might be builders, composers, creators, makers, or assemblers. They may not be applying this knowledge to any concrete goal, so applied science is not a good description, and they may be theorists or experimentalists. Constructor science is based on initial simplifier discoveries and would simply not be possible unless those discoveries were robust in almost every way. Imagine the scientific landscape as a city of buildings. The architectural toolbox produced by the simplifiers includes cables, concretes, columns, struts, and beams. Constructors put these together in imaginative ways, testing the principles of rigidity, stress, and design rules in arches, domes, and buttresses to their limits, as well as sculpting elegant forms. Any flaw in understanding the components and how they might go together is rapidly uncovered by the resounding sound of buildings collapsing. The reason we don't hear a cacophony of scientific rubble crashing to the ground is the sheer robustness of most of our knowledge. One might interpret this peaceful city as evidence of resistance to new forms, conservatism, or sloth. But actually, the serene silence pays tribute to the success of science. Computers rely on our understanding of complex physics being correct and remaining correct trillions of times every second, everywhere. This web of knowledge, that is the historical accumulation of all the science-building work of the past, is our legacy to future societies. It is composed of all the written-up reports of scientists, published in journals, their collected technologies and equipment, the know-how of all scientists alive, and the network of relationships between all these. The web is built both by the simplifiers and the constructors, who interact with each other to stimulate new science, and who together expose tears in the fabric of knowledge that need attentive mending. Because the web of knowledge is dense and taut in some areas of science, It is very difficult to disturb radically, and there are few spaces still hidden from view. On the other hand, knowing this web in some detail still does not make science into a programmatic activity that can be continued by rote. Instead, constructor science produces an astonishing litany of emerging surprises, which is perhaps the second miracle of science. These two types of science roles, simplifier and constructor, are both needed for creating the ecosystem of science. Figure 2.2 in the bonus PDF. But why should it be that understanding the components in simplifier fashion does not open up the complete architecture of all science to us? The reason is that perfect comprehension at one level of abstraction does not give enough understanding to help know what might happen when we combine components at this first level into a more complicated assembly. The rigidity of bricks does not make arches an inevitability. This is the concept of emergence, what the physicist Philip Anderson has sloganed, "More is different." It blows apart the idea that knowledge of the subatomic construction of quarks can tell us much about the biochemistry of life. The layering of the different scientific disciplines is based on this principle. We might have predicted self-replicating molecules long ago, but it was not inevitable from knowing chemistry. We stumbled across it. Constructors are those scientists who drive this emergent science. Constructors are very common in science and have always been so historically. Guglielmo Marconi, who was the first to transmit messages by radio waves from the UK to the United States, followed on from a generation of simplifier work by scientists such as James Clerk Maxwell, who uncovered the basic equations for electromagnetic waves, which include light, X-rays and microwaves, as well as radio waves. While sometimes the same scientist takes both simplifier and constructor roles, these different drives are often separated between people. Fertile mini-worlds. The handover from simplifier to constructor science in reality is very subtle. Often, in order to test whether a simplifying scientific idea is correct, an austere model is proposed, and this in turn suggests a new series of experiments on a stripped-down set of small components. To understand a poison, a particular chemical component might be injected into a cell or a specific organ, which is then observed closely. To understand the Earth's inner magnetic field, we subject tiny diamond vials of iron to enormous pressures and temperatures. Such experiments are very important in revealing a phenomenon in its simplest setting, abstracted as much as possible away from messy context, with the minimum of complicating distractions. And they are the essence of the simplifier's armory. However, the very act of removing a phenomenon from its original setting and corralling it within a protected nest in which it is coaxed to operate as close as possible to its model inherently creates new possibilities and constructs new science. A traditional realm for this use of model systems is the Gedanken or thought experiment, actually a theoretical approach coined by Hans Oerstel and dramatically exploited by Erwin Schrödinger and other pioneers in developing their quantum theories a century ago. Concerned with motion at the most microscopic level, quantum mechanics was initially used to explain the specific palette of colours emitted by aroused atoms. As well as its success in accounting for the observed polychromatic glows, for instance from sodium streetlights, these theories suggested that just watching a particular particle would actually change how it moves. The impossibility of accomplishing such experiments in the 1920s focused attention on an analytical approach that constructs thought experiments and then considers their implications. These completely idealized experiments nevertheless suggested such bizarre and wondrous conclusions that they stimulated a raft of new theories. Eventually, improved technologies enabled real experiments, which then agreed with the predictions almost entirely. Now, ever more beautiful realizations of these Gedanken experiments help young scientists, and us all, to be convinced of the essential truths of the quantum mechanical theories. We are forced to see, splattered onto a detector, the waves from chunky protein molecules that each somehow squeeze through two close-spaced pinholes at the same time. Even such big objects defiantly have a wave-like aspect. While simplifiers verify the truth of ever more sophisticated tests of quantum mechanics on individually observed particles, building such ideal constructs has stimulated constructors to envisage ways to exploit quantum systems. An entire subfield has emerged around the use of quantum mechanics to encode information that bucks the pervasive digital paradigm of binary zeros and ones, figure 2.3 in the bonus PDF. Quantum information is recorded as simultaneous combinations of one and zero, as if future electronic circuits could exist switched into both on and off states at the same time, calculating both situations at once, and thus faster. Related research measures single electrons or discusses ultra-secure quantum cryptography, ensuring no one can read and duplicate critical information you are sending, such as your bank password, or explores the teleportation of images and even possibly objects. Quantum instruments are now built that measure the gravitational pull of underground oil reserves with exquisite sensitivity, and can also detect the local electrical currents directly in your sparking brain. Thus are the models of simplifiers now reborn as tools for constructors. What do constructors do? This gives a feeling for how constructors work. They are more interested in building a new model system and seeing new behaviours emerge than in answering questions about a system provided by nature. Sometimes they have an idea, but in working through their hunch, they stumble across something completely unexpected. This is why they find it harder than simplifiers to explain why they do what they do, since they are not curing cancer or addressing similar-scale grand challenges. In fact, they often produce the critical breakthroughs that are most helpful in tackling such grand challenge problems. They cannot say beforehand that this is likely to happen, but only what they hold in their sights and its possibilities. A good example is the material science community, who are spread widely across companies and universities, with most practitioners trying to achieve diverse, ambitious, fragmented goals, but not to solve any single grand, deep mystery. On the other hand, their advances enable solutions to the other deep mysteries, such as building cameras capable of seeing the furthest galaxies or the smallest cell scaffolding. This fragmentation of the raison d'etre of constructors is what makes them both more invisible but more pervasive than simplifiers. In physics, we might take the paradigm of the hunt for the Higgs particle as archetypal simplifier science, figure 2.4 in the bonus PDF. A similar scale of effort for constructors would be the vast group of people trying to understand the implications of Maxwell's electromagnetic equations for the last century. Recent fashions, known in science as bandwagons, have shown how little understanding we have for the inherent potentialities hidden in such equations of light waves, despite our knowing exactly how to write them. We simply cannot predict what situations might be interesting to construct with intricate networks of sub-microscopic metallic wires to make metamaterials, illuminating what Abraham Flexner in 1939 referred to as the usefulness of useless knowledge. Perhaps tens of thousands of scientists worldwide are chipping away at different parts of this challenge to understand the waves of light. But the scientific participants never think in terms of it being a universally motivated grand challenge, because they work in small groups, competing with each other on tiny, detailed parts of this whole. Intellectual fragmentation is the order of the day in constructor science. public perceptions of constructors have developed more recently and do not evoke the same distinct emotional response as simplifiers. Later, we will discuss their relation to engineering and technology, but they often appear to be involved in an abstruse and complicated problem that is distanced from us by unfamiliarity. It is not always easy to identify a clear, visionary goal for a constructor. Just as building can always support a new extension and cities a new suburb, small features accrete. But out of the whole process of constructor science emerge new ideas and technologies that pervade society. Their creative process emerges not just from one individual or a specific research group, but often from a large network of cooperating and competing research teams. Depicting such a story can be very complex and is rarely attempted in its breadth. We are mostly thankful for the technological advances as they come into our hands, but unclear and disconnected from what science made them and when. We also have an ambivalence about the uses to which this science is put, from weaponry to resource extraction, which is different from merely knowing the simplifying answer to a scientific question. When we give scientists the responsibility for their offspring, is it the initial simplifiers or the following constructors who we mean to implicate? These roles of simplifier and constructor scientists will be useful throughout this book, such as in considering why so much media and political attention is focused on simplifiers. We will hear, however, that many more researchers identify with being constructors. This disconnect can be understood better through the ecosystem of science. Before I discuss this, though, we need some better idea of how many scientists in the world there really are. How many scientists are there? What counts? The throwaway answer to the question of how many scientists there are is over 6 billion, given the inbuilt propensity for every human, from their earliest childhood, to express curiosity about their surroundings through experiment and musings. Toddlers have been clearly shown to make hypotheses about their physical observations, test them, and come up with theories and beliefs. Despite the complaint that our school education systems seem to squeeze out this innate curiosity, I really don't believe it. Challenging my friends, young or old, with puzzles from my hoard of brain teasers, such as three-dimensional interlocking burrs or undulating arrays of poised magnets, and they all tend to interact with them in ways that precisely mirror scientific research. It is just that only a fraction of our societies are formally employed to use these talents on science itself. The global scale of professional scientific research can be recognized by estimating how many scientists there are and how this number might be changing. Most scientists themselves, while they have a sense of the researchers in their own subfield and a strong sense that the number they have to deal with is surging, have only a hazy idea of the total number of scientists burgeoning around the globe. The scale of the community as a whole is not in their grasp. The most recent estimates produced by UNESCO from national governments' data suggest that the number of professional scientists in the world is over 8 million. This was up from 5 million in 2002 to the most recent data from 2013, giving nearly 8 million. That is a lot of research projects, each of the 8 million involved in threading a gap in the web of knowledge. On first encounter, this number seems frighteningly large to me, especially since they are highly concentrated within small parts of the planet. Imagine a city on the scale of London, Cairo, Moscow, or Beijing, with each occupant a scientist and all vying for recognition, intensely involved in their profession. This is a very large number of people doing research, and also a staggering rate of increase. Already in 1961, Derek de Solla Price studied several measures of science activity and showed them all growing at an exponential rate. One of his conclusions was that more than 90% of all scientists who have ever lived are alive today, and this appears to have been true at every point for nearly 300 years. But things are changing. The multiplication of lab coats. Clearly, 8 million scientists cannot be aware of each other's daily work, so science is necessarily fragmented. Where are they all? In most of the Western nations, the fraction of the population counted as being in research and development, R&D, consistently settles around 0.4%. We will discuss definitions later, but essentially, all these people are involved in finding out new things. So far, there are many fewer scientists than this in China, 0.1%, India and all Africa, 0.01%. One implication is that as these nations industrialize and develop, they will focus similar fractions of their human resource on science, and the total number of scientists worldwide will exceed 25 million, a further tripling in the next 50 or more years. It is unclear whether they will enter existing subfields or the branches of science will multiply. Perhaps the existing concentration of scientists will just spread out more evenly with decreasing numbers in Western countries. Perhaps the pace of science research will increase, and we can look forward to reading of more science breakthroughs each year. Or maybe this is already at the limit. Will the quality of research they produce stay the same, or will soon each scientist be allowed to devote longer spans to getting it right? As we will hear later on, it is the internal workings of the science ecosystem that give some indication of how these matters will be resolved. Understanding the numbers is useful to grapple with such questions and many more to be raised. On the other hand, I want to avoid burdening our discussions with roving packs of figures, since this is unlikely to smooth your path to a holistic portrait of our science world. My strategy is going to be to give general messages in the text, but allow you to look at the raw data yourself as much as possible. The blog and website that go along with this book, thesciencemonster.com, have as many as possible of the links and raw data and some of the analyses. Because much of the data needed to get a fuller picture shuffles in the shadows of obscurity, a developing online community is needed to improve it. For now, inspecting the sweep of statistics will let us spot the diversity between countries and emphasize regional changes underway. One aspect of interest is how fast the number of researchers on the planet is increasing. The average annual growth rate of scientists is now over 4%, in contrast with the annual world population increase of only 1.1%. This is a massive expansion of science that would lead to a doubling of researchers every 16 years. Although the rate globally is 4% per year, figure 2.5 in the bonus PDF, it is much lower in the Western developed nations of North America, 1.6%, the EU, 1.5%, and Japan, 1.9%, all of which expanded their science base as early as the 1950s. More recently, China 12%, India 6%, Brazil 12%, Korea 9%, and lately Russia have been drawn to imitate the Western research model based on university and government investment with rapidly expanding numbers. These nations have been convinced that science research underpins their economic and manufacturing expansion in high technology areas. Inverting this view of cause and effect would instead suggest that any nation with a massively expanding high-technology industry supports a new elite who believe in sustaining science research. Who is a scientist? In considering these trends, we should be cautious of simply accepting statistics from UNESCO without understanding the difficulties in such comparisons. Only recently have agreed measures of who should be included as a researcher been adopted by different countries. These Frascati definitions, dating from 2002 and used by UNESCO, define R&D as creative work undertaken on a systematic basis to increase the stock of knowledge and its use to devise new applications. It is distinguished by the presence of an appreciable element of novelty, so it excludes routine testing, market research, patent applications, or trial production runs, but includes science development. This seems to me to correctly capture the wider community of scientists and the shared way that they work, combining researchers from industry, higher education, and government institutes, normally only a small fraction. To see the richness of approaches to science more clearly, I will imagine a situation that uses real data to identify optimal performance.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.